Welcome to The Third Story. I'm Leo Sidran. That haunting, filmic melody you're hearing behind me, that's from trumpeter Philip Dizack's recording, Jacob and the Angel. There are so many ways to set up this conversation with Philip. Here's one. He's a brilliant contemporary trumpet player who Downbeat Magazine proclaimed as one of 25 trumpet players for the future. That's not to say that he isn't for the present also. He's worked with the likes of John Batiste, Jason Moran, Ben Wendel, Orlando LaFleming, Michael Lenhart, and Aaron Parks, all former guests on this podcast, as well as Shai Maestro, Walter Smith III, Kendrick Scott, Eric Harland, Sullivan Fortner, Remy LeBouf, Dana Stevens, Thundercat, and Kamasi Washington, all people I would love to talk to for this podcast, and all great practitioners of modern music. Dizack is a musician of his moment. Here's another way to set him up. Philip Dizack has been paying his dues and putting in his time in New York for nearly two decades, mentored by masters of older generations, including Brian Lynch, Eddie Palmieri, and Bobby Watson. He's been grinding the grind, developing his sound and his concept since he was knee-high to a cheese curd. See, that leads me to yet another aspect of Philip's development. He grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, where his contemporaries included bassist Joe Sanders and pianist Dan Nimmer, both of whom are absolutely beautiful and influential musicians in their own right. And if you've been listening to this podcast for a while, you may know that I have a kind of a crush on the Milwaukee jazz scene. I see it as one of the great places for jazz in the Midwest, and I even explored it a bit some years ago as part of my Mobtown tour series and talked to Jeff Hammond and Mark Davis from the Milwaukee Jazz Institute, which we talk about here today as well. I met a young Philip Dizack shortly after I got to New York in 2005. I got a job writing music for TV commercials, and on my very first day, I got hired to write a traditional swing music track. I didn't know very many people in town, so I called my friend, the piano player Tim Whalen, who had just finished his master's degree at the Manhattan School of Music, and he told me to call Phil Dizack, a young hotshot trumpet player from Milwaukee. Tim knew I would appreciate that, who was getting his undergraduate degree from the same school. I remember thinking at the time when I first heard Philip that he had a deep respect for the tradition and a very open sensibility. In today's conversation, we talk about that and how, in fact, he believes that he didn't really come into contact with the fullness of the history and legacy of playing jazz until he began teaching at a university last year. While he was at the Manhattan School of Music, Dizack also became friends with another great trumpeter, Ambrose Akinmusiri. And in our conversation today, he talks about how fundamental that relationship has been to him. At one point, he says, "There are torchbearers, and for me, it's Ambrose. Because I admire him so much, it's really hard for me to accept where I am or what I thought was good. He just set the bar so high that it almost feels like I'd be lying to myself if I said, okay, now I'm content." Philip moved to Denton, Texas in 2019 to join the faculty at the University of North Texas, and he was in the middle of his first year of teaching when the pandemic hit. Sometime in the spring, he texted me a photo from a book of jazz interviews that he was reading. Coincidentally, it was my dad's book. It's called Talking Jazz, which features some of the interviews that he did with jazz legends in the 80s. After some back and forth texting, we decided to get on the phone and catch up. And that's what this episode really is. Something between a more structured career retrospective interview and a temperature check in the time of COVID. A conversation on what and how he thinks about playing, teaching, practicing, potential, and perspective. I really enjoyed this one. Third-story.com is your place to go to get involved, sign up, subscribe, say hello, check out the playlist and the videos that I curated for this episode. Check out previous episodes, including the aforementioned ones with John Batiste, Jason Moran, Ben Wendel, Orlando LaFleming, Michael Lenhart, Aaron Parks, and the Mobtown episode about Milwaukee. You can also become a patron of this project at patreon.com/thirdstorypodcast. The link is also on my website. Follow me on all the socials at Third Story Pod, everywhere you socialize in the media way. And finally, it's time for me to remind you to leave a review on Apple Podcasts. Do it. Leave a review. If you like this thing, leave a review. If you don't like it, lie and say that you do. If you really like it, why not leave two? Or how about four or five stars to me from you? Phew, that was hard to get through. And now, without further ado, here's me and Philip Dizack speaking something true. Philip Dizack.
Leo.
Let's hear this. Let's hear this quality.
How do we sound?
I think we sound pretty good. Okay, so first of all, describe to me, please, you know, the scene around you. Tell me where you are right now.
Are we live?
We're live, but I'm going to cut you. I'm going to edit you so tightly that by the time it's over.
Okay, but I just got to know. I'm in Denton, Texas,
yeah,
which is 30 minutes outside of Dallas, near University of North Texas, and I'm in an apartment. I would say a lot of people wear masks, but some people just don't care because it's Texas and they like to do what they want to do, I suppose.
Is Denton like Madison or Austin or one of those places that leans a little bit to the left?
It's very, for Texas, I mean, I haven't been to a lot of places in Texas, really any at this point, but it seems, it's pretty liberal. Like, it's definitely a bubble being in, that it's a university, a lot of young, educated people, a lot of, you know, like, I'm in a music school, and for the most part, musicians, creative types, very often are pretty liberal. So
yeah.
My environment feels like I'm in Wisconsin or something, like in Milwaukee or something.
Yeah.
In that sense.
I've been thinking about you a lot because when you took this job at North Texas, which I don't need to tell you this, it's a prestigious job. That's a prestigious conservatory. That's a well-known music school. That's a big job, the likes of which there are very few in the country. I totally understand why you took that gig. Even still, when you took it, you know, you were saying to me and to everybody else, I'm going to be back and forth a lot. I'm going to go to Europe a lot. I'm going to go to New York a lot. And, you know, we'll see. I hope that continues to be true. But in the meantime, like, New York is not a really great place to be right now, particularly yeah. as a jazz musician.
Right. And I think it won't be for quite some time.
I agree.
It seems.
I mean, I guess that's what I'm asking. Like, you know, so how is your thinking about this move? I mean, if you had any compunction or question about it, like, has your thinking about having moved to Texas evolved over the last few months?
Well, I feel like I snuck out just in time. And I feel really fortunate that I just, like, in the 11th hour got an ideal situation, which was already, like, I had some reservation. And then I remember Walter Smith texted me. I don't talk to Walter a lot, but he texted me, said he, when the news came out that I got the job, and he said, congratulations. And immediately when he texted me, I was like, oh, maybe it's good that I accepted this gig. Because, you know, somebody who I admire so much, and who's also very busy, but also holds a university position now as a chair at Berkeley. So I hadn't applied to any other jobs.
Right.
I had friends who were teaching there, who were teaching at UNT, colleagues. And one of them was like, you know, you should really just apply. And I asked a bunch of questions. He's like, well, the due date is like in 2 days. So if you're at all interested, just apply, just send in an application. And, you know, if you're at all interested. And so that's what I did. And I ended up getting it. And, you know, even when it seemed like when I was at the school, it seemed like the probability was quite high that I was going to have the job. I just figured, like, there was any musician who was at I'm relevant to New York. My generation is very relevant right now. Any trumpet player who's as relevant as I am, I think is working more than I am, or already has a teaching gig.
Huh.
That's how it feels. So I felt like if they wanted somebody who was really, who the students would know well, who would move to Texas, I thought the list was quite small.
And so did you get one semester in? When did you move?
I moved in the fall, and I taught from in the fall semester, and then half of this semester, and then we went into quarantine in March. So I taught, but the thing about it is pretty much all of February I was gone.
You're on the road.
So I was on the road. Yeah, so everything was great in February. February, I was like, oh, great. I'm still teaching. Some people, you know, some of my TAs are covering my classes. I felt like I was gone a little too much for how new the job was for me. So there's still quite a learning curve. Yeah, and then all this stuff happened.
Is this something that you thought about? I mean, was a teaching gig of this scale and level of commitment, was that something that you were thinking about? Like in the New York world, a lot of times people think about like maybe doing some kind of halftime thing, or, you know, doing something where they could, you know, not have to commit on the level of moving to another state.
I mean, when I was in New York, I was providing for my wife and I. For the most part, I was the only breadwinner. So a lot of times I felt like I had a boot on my neck. Mm. Where just I was sort of, I had to say yes to a lot of things, just life.
I'm not going to take that personally. I'm going to choose not to take that personally.
To say yes to.
To say to yes you, to when I called you.
Yeah, no, I like you.
I like you too.
No, but it's just, I had, you know, I
yeah, there of were course.
Things where it's like, can you do this? I say, well, yeah. I'm free. So the answer has to be yes, you know,
right.
Like, and there's a, you know, I put in my dues. That's for sure.
Yeah.
And when I got here and I'm like, oh wow, I have a salary and health insurance and I have access to the music building 24 hours a day. I have an office I can practice in 24 hours a day. It's like, you know, and then I still get to travel like 3 to 4 weeks a semester.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to beat. And you know, they give, I mean, they're cutting down on this now because, you know, everybody's struggling, but they would give travel stipends to go to New York or, you know, to play gigs. So it was really easy to say yes to. And then when I got in it and I was still traveling for the things that were important to me, I think I had to miss one tour for the whole year, like a 10-day tour,
mm-hmm.
which was kind of a drag, but it's like, I knew it was going to happen, but that was the worst of it.
And then also, you know, Denton and Dallas, they have a good scene, right? There's a lot of good players there. So it's not like you're out in the provinces trying to find a good rhythm section. There's good players there.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I know Bobby Sparks lives out here. Sparks is the organist for like RH Factor and a bunch of other things. But I've known him for a number of years. And so, and him and Jason Thomas, JT, the drummer from RH Factor. So I knew those guys for a long time. But I've only seen Bobby twice. I was really, really sort of like trying to keep my head above water this first year. Just the learning curve is steep, and also I was quite busy.
So, man, it's interesting to hear you say about paying your dues, you know, because I have this memory of meeting you. You're younger than me, but you were already in New York when I moved to New York. And the first day I moved into that music company, that Jingle House, my first day on the job, I had to record a jingle. And our mutual friend Tim Whalen, who had just left Manhattan School of Music, told me to call you. You were from Milwaukee. You were young and good guy to know. And you came in at the time. I mean, I think you were you finishing up undergraduate at the time?
Yeah, that's the only degree I have. So it must have been that.
Right. Well, good. Then my memory serves me well.
2007.
2005, I called you in.
Yeah.
Your class of 2007. So 2005, you came in and you were a kid. I mean, you were definitely closer. If you had one foot in New York, I mean, the other one was still very planted in Milwaukee. You still, I mean, I identified with you because I had come from Madison. You came from Milwaukee.
Right.
But you were like a kid. And, you know, so I feel in a funny way like I got to see, even if it's from a distance, like the whole trajectory of what you are now defining as having paid all these dues. And I guess, you know, the thing that like lit me up about meeting you originally was that you had come out of Milwaukee, because I think I probably had said to you back then, like, I'm from Madison, but like I have a thing about Milwaukee. I really always admired the scene and the level in Milwaukee. That's not a question, that's a statement, but I would like you to respond. I would like you to respond to it nonetheless.
It's sort of hard to have perspective when you come from somewhere until you leave that place for an extended period of time, and you sort of get to reflect on yourself for an extended period of time. So, I mean, I don't really know Milwaukee as it is now, but I do know that, like, you know, growing up, I grew up with Joe Sanders. I just thought a bass player sounded like Joe Sanders. It took me a long time to realize why I didn't like that many bass players, because of how great he was. And And, you know, there was like a lot of people came through there, and I had good mentorship from all the faculty at the Milwaukee Conservatory, which is now, I should mention, is now the Milwaukee Jazz Institute.
Hmm.
There was some like corruption in the on the board, and so all of the jazz faculty quit and started this thing called the Milwaukee Jazz Institute. So just a quick shout out to that.
And is and that's Hammond and Mark Davis and
Mark Davis. Yeah, yeah, Mark Davis sort of was like the whistleblower, and he got ousted, and then the rest of the guys followed him in short time after, and then they started their own sort of institute. So which I you know it sucks because they don't have the financial support that they had, but I think it was necessary, and it's still like that sort of mentorship is still going on.
Yeah.
And then Brian Lynch was always coming back to Milwaukee, and he was a great mentor for me when I was younger. Yeah, they also had the saxophone player Berkeley Fudge, who
yes.
lived. I don't know if he's still around, if he's still playing. I really don't know. But he was like from a different time. He just felt like tradition when you were around him. Like there were so many levels that you just didn't understand.
Yeah,
but you understood and its importance. That's at least my recollection of it. Right. You know, I was young at the time. I was you know naive. Yeah, but Milwaukee was a what I liked about it was like big enough that there were great musicians there, but small enough that you could sit in on any gig if you
yeah.
could play at all. Right. So there was this open, like sort of this like open door policy and it was always very supportive. And so I never felt disconnected from the scene at all.
And was Dan Nimmer around your age?
Dan Nimmer was a couple of years older than me, maybe like 5 years older,
mm-hmm.
something like that. And my father is an audio technician. He did some work for this gentleman who owned a recording studio. And when I was a junior in high school, my dad said to this guy, he said, you know, don't pay me, give my son some recording time.
Hmm.
So he bartered a couple hours of recording time for me. And I went in the studio with this drummer, Andy Bauer,
mm-hmm.
And then Joe Sanders and Dan Nimmer. And somewhere we have this, like demo CD or something, like three or four songs of us playing. And when the recording engineer asked if we wanted how much reverb I wanted, I said I didn't want any. And it was like a completely dry room. So we have this the driest quartet recording possibly imagined. But it's with myself, Joe Sanders, Dan Nimmer, and Andy Bauer.
Why did you say no reverb?
I don't know. I just didn't know anything about reverb, so I just was like, yeah, I don't think I want any.
Yeah.
Didn't know.
You know, I have a Dan Nimmer record that I made the day before he moved to New York.
Who doesn't? You know what I mean?
I guess part of the reason I'm thinking about Milwaukee is because of my own personal connection to Wisconsin in that scene. And the other one is because you know, I like the way you kind of lay out the idea of a scene that is big enough that people can play, but small enough that if you show talent and interest and show up, you can sit in because now you've made your way back to another kind of small market. I mean, it's a little bit different because there's a huge music school there and it's close to a big city. But, you know, on some level, I feel like you kind of have the preparation to live in a, a city of that size.
Yeah, it. I like where you're going with this. However, I mean, my time in Milwaukee was just like, I was just doing what I thought was really fun.
Yeah.
I didn't have any perspective of what a scene was, of what it, you know, what it was to like to work in a small. I didn't think of that at all.
Yeah.
And then I went to New York, and after New York, it's New York and every other place.
Yeah.
And so this feels like every other place, and there's a handful of really excellent musicians, but it's not New York.
Right.
And the energy is different. I mean, I don't know how the energy is now in New York, but. In normal times, the energy is not New York. And so it just doesn't have the same, you're not on edge. You don't have to practice, you know, I do all the time, I should say. But I mean, there's not this like, you don't have to be ready for tonight.
Man, that is so interesting because I think about that a lot with my friends. You know, my friend Lage Lund just moved to Norway. Yeah. And I saw a picture of his kitchen. And I said, man, you are never going to practice again. I mean, what motivation do you have to do anything other than sit in that beautiful kitchen? It's just too beautiful.
Man, I actually feel like when you're out of New York, at least for me, my New York time was so, though I appreciate, I can't wait to see Lage's kitchen.
Oh, it looks like good.
My time in New York, for the most part, was just busy. Like, I was doing things that I love to do. I was also doing things I had to do. I was also teaching because I had to. I remember talking to, I forget who it was about this, but they said, the thing, it's so hard to stay creative in New York because you have to fill up, I mean, unless you get to a tipping point, you have to fill up all of your time with making money.
Yep.
That's just how it is.
Yep.
I mean, there is a tipping point, and like, we know a lot of people who have cross that tipping point in New York. But that means that you're not in New York that much.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's two things. Either you're a New York person so that you can get gigs outside of New York, or a lot of people I've noticed, you know, when I think about it, a lot of people that reach a certain level of establishment, like real career, they leave. They're not here. You know, I mean, I just think about like so many of the musicians I admire that are older, Dave Holland, Scofield, Dejanette, you know, they're all upstate, just for an example of a generation of people that, you know, are not in town.
Yeah. But that generation's different. That's also like they moved upstate before upstate was expensive.
Right. No, exactly. No,
that's desirable.
They moved to the country, but they moved to a place where they could have more space and whatever, have a quieter life. But I mean, that's just an indication that as soon as it became a possibility not to have to deal with it, they got out.
This is really interesting for me to, because I sent you the photo. This is sort of instigated our conversation, but of like me reading your father's, the transcription of all those interviews.
Yeah.
It's funny because I just thought like, I'm doing the same thing right now that what I just was reading Sonny Rollins' interview or Max Gordon's interview. It's like I'm doing the same thing that they're doing in a different generation. It's sort of, I just had this like connection where it sort of feels a little surreal.
I appreciate you saying that because every now and then, look, I try not to in any way draw the direct line between the conversations that he had and the ones that I had. Not that I don't think the people I'm talking to are important or significant or that these aren't historical documents, but I have been thinking a lot about the generation that he was able to talk to and the cultural context that they belong to.
Yeah.
And ours. And it's just a different, you know, some people I've talked to have a foot in both worlds, but I mean, you know, it's different now. I mean, look, there was almost no jazz education at all for any of the people that he talked to.
Yeah, that's true. I just read Archie Shepp's interview.
Yeah.
And what Archie Shepp was like, he made a point of being an intellect.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, he was like the professor at Amherst or University of Amherst or something.
Yeah.
But even him, when your dad makes references to like how people said that Archie Shepp had like Ben Webster's sound or a sound just as beautiful as his, even Archie Shepp is like, you know, I really appreciate that, but come on, Ben Webster is like the greatest of all time. Yeah. That's something I almost can't accept. It was like sort of like the same comment that you just made about how like not to draw the importance. You know, there's all this like there's like every
yes.
If our perspective is right, then we're always in complete humility of what came before us.
Do you think that humility is still there now with young musicians?
It's case by case, but definitely.
I've been thinking a lot about how as we get further and further away, not only from musically, but also culturally, from the content, the context, the constructs that created the blues, the Black American experience, it is less and less connected to a lot of kids who start to play music in general. You know, Bird is a long way away now.
I do think there are torchbearers, and I think there are people who do their due diligence. And like, if you eat of that olive branch, then you sort of get to dig deeper. For me, that person is Ambrose, who's a good friend of mine, but is a couple years older than me. We went to Manhattan School of Music together. Because I admire his artistry, his attention to detail, his intellect, his work ethic, and his playing, and his process. It's like, because I admire all those things, it's really hard for me to accept where I am or where I thought what I thought was good. Because he's, for in my eyes, so innovative and so thorough. Regardless if you like it or what he's doing or not, it's irrelevant. But it's, he just set the bar so high for me and everybody else that I feel like I'd be lying to myself if I was like, okay, cool, now I'm content, let's play. Which I know, you know, you never get there. Even like reading like Sonny Rollins interviews, like from your dad's book and from what I reread Notes and Tones by Arthur Taylor.
Taylor, yeah.
When I read Sonny Rollins' interviews, like they're almost, he's like really insecure and sometimes self-deprecating. And I see how that led to him being really great, but I also see how that led to him dampening his greatness while it was happening. And I'm, you know, obviously I'm not trying to compare myself to Sonny Rollins, but I do see the benefit of me being like, you know what, the things that I'm practicing or what I am working on or what I don't feel comfortable with, or I haven't put out a record in this many years or whatever, like just because I'm heavily developing, because I have like these very close examples of greatness. Obviously we have people who are further away, like you said, like Charlie Parker or Miles Davis or Louis Armstrong or whoever. Or Coltrane, whatever, whoever it may be, it's like but the ones who are really close are the ones that have the biggest impact. And so if you have somebody like
you Ambrose, have Ambrose, yeah,
like, you know, I think a lot of people have him, but you know, I have a special connection because we practiced together a lot. I got to just be by. I never studied his playing. I was playing with him a lot in college. But because I have that, it's sort of like I get in this place where it's like I can go down the Sonny, or I am going down the Sonny Rollins practice on the bridge sort of time in my life where I think I sound horrible. I know I'm developing a lot and working on a lot of things, but it's like I hear so far beyond what I'm capable of doing right now. And I don't know if that gets better or worse as I get older.
You told me one time, I mean, I think we had a phone call one time that was just like literally like the full trajectory of the Monk competitions that you did.
Yeah.
And the first one, if I remember, Ambrose won. The first one that you did, Ambrose won.
Yeah.
You know, you told me that story, but I didn't know the full context of how much he meant to you at the time. You know,
yeah.
I'm thinking about that now and thinking about how on top of all of everything you're describing, like you had to go out there and quote unquote compete with this guy who, you know, was so important to you.
Well, but at that time, I didn't think the gap was that large. I just didn't, because I was just enjoying my time doing what I was doing. I didn't, you know, I was much younger. And, you know, and that's not what it's about. It's not like where I am versus him. However, when you see somebody who through their diligent work ethic and like investigative listening and reading and musical and academic research are growing so tremendously and becoming and are so innovative and so like thought provoking, and also happen to be very close to you in your life experience. Yeah, it's super. I could see how it could either be like people said that they heard Charlie Parker and they quit.
Yeah,
like it could either be that, or it could be unbelievably encouraging.
Well, for you, it sounds like it's a bit of both.
Yeah, I think on at this point, it's just very encouraging.
Yeah,
and the things that I'm practicing are the absolute simplest things because I'm just I realize in order to progress, you have to go or innovate or progress to a certain level. I think you have to go through everything, and any missing ingredient is gonna come out in the final product.
So what are you working on?
I've just broken down everything that I want to do into like the simplest mm-hmm. things. So it's like, okay, I want to work on I'm playing with in Shai Maestro's band now.
Yep, I saw.
And so like he has a song in 11/8, and he has a song in 13/8. And you know, for me, this is like the first time I've had to do anything besides like 6/8.
Really?
I mean, to this extent where his band, like Jorge
Roder
and Ofri Nehemia and Shai, they're like, they've spent a lot of time with this, and their control over like 11/8, they had the song for last year or two. Their control over that meter, for example, is like as though they're playing 4/4.
Yeah.
Which for me, I couldn't even find one for 2 months. And then he wrote a song in 13 for his latest record, which we recorded. And so I was like, you know, I have all this time. Let me like really get this together. So yeah. I started working on 13/8. You know, I started going down that rabbit hole even more. And then I was like, you know, actually, this is harder than 11/8. Let me work on 11/8. And then I got eventually, you know, after a while, I got all the way down to like, let me play groupings of 3/5/8.
Why is 13 harder than 11?
Because there's more possibilities. Huh. Because you can have 9 + 2 + 2.
How do you think about 11? You think about it 9 + 2?
No, I'm not there yet. I'm only on 7. I've started breaking down everything that I'm doing to like the foundational elements of what I'm doing. So like for this, it was like I can play in 3/4. I mm-hmm. can play in 4/4. Mm-hmm. Let me work on. I can play in 3/8 or 6/8. It's not hard. Okay, let me do 5/8. Mm-hmm. Let me start there. And so I started there, and I just like pretty much was like trying to play drums on my body and sing solos at the same time. And I figured if I could do that super freely and play over the bar line,
or sing over the bar line,
exactly, sing over the bar line, then playing is no problem, and that gives me extreme control. Mm. But that started with like let me just tap out polyrhythms like with both hands in 5/8. Everything that I'm doing right now is like starting from that sort of foundational.
I mean, you should maybe, it sounds like you need to get like an Ari Honig book or something. Get, you know what I mean? Get a drum book. The process sounds like you're studying rhythm.
Exactly.
You're studying drums.
Well, first of all, Shai played in Ari Honig's band.
Yeah.
So that is the right place to go. But yeah, I watched Ari Honig's My Music Masterclass video.
Yep.
That's exactly where I went.
As a drummer, as a bass player, as any accompanying type of instrument, you're going to want to know and be familiar with the other parts of the subdivision. Groupings of 7.
What is it like soloing in a context where you don't know where one is? I mean, how do you approach it in those terms?
I tried to take the other section.
Yeah.
I mean, we've only played maybe like 8 gigs with the band. So there were only 8 times where I wasn't sure where one was. The thing is, in relationship to most every other musician, I was far beyond where they are because most people don't go through that process. I never had gone through that process. But in relationship to how Shai's trio was playing it, I wasn't nearly on their level. And so they were so free with it where I was just trying to hold on. So,
right.
But it was just like a, we're getting ready for the record type thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, we found the place that I should go and where he should play. And that's just how this process went. Because this is how I didn't get a lot of time to play with them.
Yeah.
As I pretty much just joined the band.
Has teaching changed your or affected or influenced the way you think about what you work on and or just changed your approach at all?
Definitely. The first semester I was teaching, I had to teach a course on bebop for a semester. It's like 15 weeks.
Yeah.
And two one-hour classes a week.
Yeah.
I was writing up my syllabus and I got about to the sixth class.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, I have 24 more classes to go. Yeah. What am I going to talk about?
Huh.
And it showed me a lot of what I didn't know.
Huh.
And it showed me how to get information. It like taught me how to research. And I realized that up until that point, everything that I had learned, the process that I had learned it in, had been a very natural process.
Yes.
It didn't require much of me. It was all about like what was very natural and like where my talent was and like how good my ears were or what, you know, it's like it didn't require me to like do the academic work of like research and planning. It wasn't super specific. And preparing for my teaching is the most helpful thing that I've ever done for myself and that I recommend to every, like any student that I have. Like if they can't figure out how to do something, write a syllabus for it.
Huh.
Because by the time you get to class number 7 or 8 or 9, you're going to see what you don't know really quickly. And then what most likely will happen, this is what I did, I started watching like other people's master classes. I started calling people and saying, if you were talking about this subject, what were the important things that you would talk about? Like, how would you address this problem? And it's like, and then you can start, it's just like a learning how to research. That was something that I didn't.
Yeah.
Learning how to find an answer. That was something that I hadn't had to do.
But it's interesting because, I mean, as you said earlier, you have an undergraduate degree, I'm assuming, in jazz trumpet performance.
Mm-hmm.
As you describe your education, everything was quite natural and intuitive, and it focused on leaning into the stuff that you do well. And, you know, I've always seen you as somebody who's deeply respectful of the tradition, deeply respectful of where you came from and the legacy of the instrument and all that, you know. And
that's the thing. That's the perception that I gave.
Huh.
And I don't want to say that I was not, of course, I wasn't disrespectful, but I was ignorant for sure. And I mean, a very tangible example of this, I have two stories, both of which the second of which I'm not proud of, the first of which I don't really care that much. The first of which is about 251s, the second of which is about Charlie Palmieri. But the first of which, when I was a senior in high school, I went to this jazz camp that I had been at for a year or two prior, and that was Mike Lee, the tenor player,
who
lives in New Jersey. Yeah, I was taking a lesson with him, and he was like, well, here, play me a 251 over, you know, like to C major or something. He said something like that. He's like, what would you play over a 251? And I was like, well, I don't know. How does it sound? And I just had I didn't even know what that was.
Yeah.
And so, but he thought I had all these ways of playing over a 251.
Of what you were playing, just what you sounded like?
Because
at that point?
What I was sounding like, because I was just listening to a lot of recordings, but I didn't know. I mean, outside of reading the bass note, I couldn't read a chord, at all, not in the slightest. So then I remember even like when I first got to Manhattan School of Music, like when I was auditioning, someone said, "Oh yeah, you know this teacher, he was accompanying me for placing in improv class or something, and so he played a sharp four. So I played a sharp four, and then he played a sharp four, and I was like, I don't even know what a sharp four is.
Yeah,
but I was playing the way I sounded, and it didn't come across that way. So. And then...
Well, you probably were playing it. I mean, you probably didn't know it, but you were playing it. You knew it, but you didn't know it.
Exactly. That'll convince you, Leo, that I have respect for the tradition. But then I go and play Eddie Palmieri's gig. And after playing 2 years with Eddie Palmieri, I say, oh, Charlie Palmieri, what did he play? Which I will tell you didn't go over well. I wasn't in the band much after that. Oh, no, actually, that was like after like 7 years. I think I didn't know the story well enough for me to investigate the story.
I want to clarify, Charlie Palmieri played keyboards. Okay.
Yeah, Eddie Palmieri's brother.
Is it his older brother?
His older brother, yeah.
He's also a piano player.
Yeah, but that would be like going, Thad Jones and be like, oh, you have brothers? Who are
right,
they?
Right.
Like, I'm a big fan of your work. Oh, you who are your brothers?
I mean, it's interesting, though, because on the other hand, I am hearing you say something else, which is that I've thought about this a lot. When we learn a language, we learn how to speak English and communicate with one another and speak this language, and we may have never read Shakespeare or Hemingway, you know? And yet we still learn the language. Like, some of it is learning a language. It sounds like you had that language very early, and you just didn't know who the great innovators in the language were necessarily. Or maybe you did, but you didn't exactly know the technique that they were using in order to innovate.
Well, you know, I did, and it's like, I felt like I could, maybe if an example would be like, oh, I could alter my voice to make it sound just like Martin Luther King, and I can use a bunch of those words, but that doesn't make me a great orator.
Right.
That's what sort of clicked for me. It's like, oh, I this might be super obvious to a lot of people, but it wasn't to me until very recently. I was like, oh, the reason why I practice all of these things is because I want to be an orator. I want to have every possible word out of my mouth that I just need one word to describe everything.
Yes.
And I want to play like that. I mean, that's a very obvious statement, but it didn't click for me. And where that information comes from and who were the torchbearers of that information, it wasn't a top priority for me because I didn't understand it enough. To come back to your question of like, has teaching changed it? Yeah, dramatically, because I've had to ask a lot more questions and I've had to be more specific with the way I ask questions, and I had to have a why for my answers.
Teaching has changed you because it has forced you to ask questions.
Yeah, which I was already doing, but it forced me to ask direct enough questions because I had to get, I just had to become so specific. I mean, 30 classes is a really long time to be talking to a group of students about a subject when they have 30 classes for 4 years, twice a year.
Yeah.
That's a lot of material.
And that's what's so deep about it is like the thing that kind of qualifies you to teach these classes is not that you've come with all of these years of researching this stuff. It's your playing and your experience as a player. And yet what you're describing is actually having to get this whole other aspect together.
Yeah. But I do feel like I did a really good job of playing around the history.
Yeah.
So much so that you, very educated, very well listened.
Yes.
That you say, it sounds like,
even
when you were younger, you had a great appreciation of the history and your instrument. Yeah, I did a really good job of getting really close.
Is it going to change your playing? Is it changing your playing or the way you think about playing?
Yeah, totally. When I think there's a couple people that come to mind. Like when I hear Sullivan Fortner, for example.
Yes.
I feel like anything that Sullivan plays is an amalgamation or a culmination of everything that happened up until the time period that he's playing from.
When you said this thing about Martin Luther King, that's what I heard you say is like, I want to be able to open my mouth and say one thing.
Yeah.
And have you know that it's me and have it be meaningful.
Well, I haven't even gotten to the have it be me yet.
Oh, really?
No, I mean, I'm just saying I wasn't even necessarily talking about that. I was just talking about like, just, I think that that's going to be there. I mean, that's, I think the more decisions that you have the ability to make, the more you'll be yourself. So that's sort of like, at this point, that's like, I'm going to be myself.
Hey, that's interesting that you say the more decisions that you have the ability to make, the more you'll be yourself. Because I've always thought that maybe part of what makes you who you are is your limitations.
I would say I suppose knowledge or the lack of knowledge could influence you to be yourself or not be yourself. Yeah. So, I mean, like it could be a huge influencer for me. It's not at this point, it's going to have no adverse effect.
Yeah.
The more I get to decide for myself, the more clearly my spirit will come through. I know that.
See, I think part of what you are describing, although you're identifying it as a kind of a weakness or a failing that you're filling in now, I think that part of what you're describing is a kind of a native acquisition of the language.
Totally. I that's exactly how I feel like I learned. And that's exactly how I can still relate to the language, where it's like, oh, wait, how do I use a semicolon?
Yeah.
Oh, they're using the, yeah. And that's what, that's what I'm going through right now. I'm like trying to come at it from the other side of it. So
yep.
Just like something I'm doing right now is just, let me sit at the piano, I'm playing through a Piano for Non-Pianists book.
Oh, cool.
And I'm just going through it and making sure I can do everything. I'm just filling in gaps.
Yeah.
I want to be a very, not prolific.
Proficient.
Yes, piano player, you know, just like for harmonic reasons.
Is some of this work that you're doing like a result of the quarantine situation? Like you have time to work on this? Was this on your mind already?
I think after like 2 weeks, I started really settling up quarantine. I started like really settling into getting closer to the actual questions that I was trying to answer. I got this thing from Miguel Atwood Ferguson. Like he wrote out, you know, do you know him, a violist?
No, I don't LA? Know. No.
He plays with like Flying Lotus and Thundercat. And
yeah.
Does like a lot of scoring for Netflix. Anyway, he's great, really great musician in LA that I have known since I lived out there. But anyway, he had this like worksheet where he would like have like 10 or 15 different categories of like things that he had to do every day.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it was like meditate or workout, play Bach, play piano, whatever it was, you know, that was whatever his work. And then every day you like check off what you did and didn't do, and you sort of figure out your percentages for the day and then your percentages for the week of each item. Like maybe I suck at composing, but I realize that I've only done it 20% of the days of the week. So of course I'm not that good at it, you know? So I did that and I had all these things. I had like 12 different things that, you know, I'm going to play long tones and then I'm going to do my lip slurs and then I'm going to work on this solo and then I'm going to do these rhythmic things and then I'm working on some piano stuff and then I'm going to play some Bach and then I'm going to whatever it was. And as the weeks went on, this list got very small and now there's only like 3 things.
Dig it.
So I've just become a lot more focused and deliberate in my practice. And I think because we've had nothing else to do, I've been able to do that. And because I know that I have time to do it.
I love the idea that although you have nothing else to do, the list is getting shorter, not longer.
Yeah.
Because it means that you're spending more time and more focused time on the stuff that you're doing and figured out what you could kind of eliminate for now.
Yeah, well, also because the more specific your questions get, the more black and white your answers become.
Huh.
And because of that, it's really obvious I need to accomplish this task. I mean, I need to work on this very specific thing, and this is a building block for this next thing. I, you know, it's like you can write an outline, like a, you know, bulleted outline, and you know, if it's like, okay, I want, you know, whatever you're trying to accomplish, it's like under that, it's like, okay, I have to do these 3 tasks, and under those 3 tasks, you have like 5 different things you have to do, and under that, it's like, okay,
I learn
how to play my chromatic scales without cracking a note, you know, whatever it is. It's like it becomes so simple that it's like, let me just spend the next week working on this one very simple thing.
Yeah.
And not only is it super encouraging, but it's like my path of growth is very clear. See, I think a lot of people practice this way. I just have never practiced this way. I sort of practice sort of like haphazardly from a point. Like I think I saw the macro very well. Like, I could feel that, you know, it's like I know the vibe. I know how to play with heart and conviction. And I have 89% of the time I'm going to play the right harmony. I have my little, subconsciously, I think I have my tricks of ways to get around my shortcomings. And so I can be successful. But I think as I continue to develop, like, you hear things that you didn't hear. And so you know that the people who are at a higher level than you, it's an arbitrary statement, but who are people who you respect, who can do things that you can't do, hear what you're not doing.
But then again, they might not. I mean, you know, maybe you do. Maybe you're hearing things that people around you aren't doing in a way that you didn't hear before as your ear gets developed. And then on the other hand, sometimes I think the thing about that is that nobody else is in your head.
Yeah.
I think a lot of times what the rest of the world is hearing is what you are doing, not what you're not doing. The only one who knows what you're not doing is you and why you're not doing it.
I had you fooled.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
You're right. And there's like, this is like the Sonny Rollins
dilemma.
If you're being self-critical, like, there's a fine line between it being helpful and being a little bit of a detriment, because there's always going to be stuff to learn. But I think once your eyes, I hope, when your eyes become open to the big picture and you really see it for the first time, that hopefully that's the only time that it's that overwhelming.
There's a part of me that's just feeling, talking to you, like how, on the one hand, in economic terms, in terms of stability of life, all of the kind of tangibles that we use to measure safety and security in our lives, jazz musicians are the least prepared for pandemic. And but in a different version of the same story, jazz musicians are totally used to having to hold themselves accountable on a level that nobody else can do for them, that you have to wake up and make that list every day. I mean, once you're out of school, like, you know, maybe when you're in school, somebody tells you to work on some shit, so you work on it. But eventually you're not in school. I mean, at a certain point, there's nobody in charge anymore except for you and what you hold yourself accountable for. That's the same all the time, you know, that you kind of have to figure it out for yourself in order to develop and survive and thrive as a creative musician.
I think that's the case for anybody who's rewarded on their output. Like, who's the reward directly is associated with their effort and their drive, or their ability to have self-motivation.
Yeah.
Like, you know, if, obviously it's not the case if you have a 9-to-5 and you go to a job. I know that now. Like, it's not the case. Like, it doesn't matter what I do or don't do. As long as I hold that position, I get to reap the benefits. So, you know, as a musician, it's like, the work that you get, the people that you get to play with, how it feels to play, the freedom you have, it's like that all has a direct correlation to your dedication and how clear your goals are and how consistent your drive is.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting. I was talking to my wife about that today, and she was saying, you know, most people, because when I was growing up, my dad used to say to me, like, one of the hardest jobs that you're going to have is figuring out what to do with your downtime. When you don't have a gig, that's your time. You're in charge of that time. And you have to decide what you're going to do with that time and how to make that valuable to you. Like, that's been something that I've been thinking about my whole life. And, you know, my wife was saying, you know, most people don't think about being out of work in those terms. They just freak out and they just think like, oh my God, I don't have work. I have nothing to do. I need, you know, as opposed to looking at it as, it's counterintuitive sometimes, especially when money's at play, but as an opportunity.
Yeah, I mean, I think that a lot of people are really happy right now. For the people who have either accepted the economic situation or have gotten grants or aren't struggling financially, this is a fantastic time.
For self-realization, self-actualization, whatever.
Yeah, I mean, if you've been trying to have some time to shed, wow, this is great. Are you kidding?
I mean, but also that's the thing about that, which I like. I mean, I love that. I love that sentiment, because on the other side of it, of course, we also know it's hard to imagine how clubs come back in the same way. Meanwhile, I mean, I went back and listened to some interviews that I was doing just at the end of last year with musicians who were saying, yeah, the scene is great, but you can't make a living. And, you know, those clubs are always hanging from a very thin thread. And, like, it's not like even restoring it to what it was is anywhere near what anybody wanted it to be. And now here everybody's pining away for an economic model that was very fraught to begin with.
Well, I came to New York after 9/11, like 2 years after 9/11.
Yep.
And I had people asking me, like, I started playing with Bobby Watson right when I was out of school. And people were asking me, like, I did a couple of interviews, like, you know, how has it been going? You know, it's like that with the economy. And I was like, this is the only thing I've known. So everything's fine.
Yeah.
And so something that I think, you know, we hear a lot, especially a lot of complaints about, like, how now it's, you know, times are different. But before the pandemic, when people would say, oh, man, but, you know, the days of this, you know, like when we were making so much money in the studio and all this stuff, people are complaining about streaming services. It's like people were only making making money off of records for less than 100 years.
Yeah.
And they weren't most of the people weren't making money off of them, not even for that long.
That's absolutely true.
The artist, that is.
And the models keep changing. They've changed many times. That's exactly right.
Everything's changed. I'm just saying, it's like everything is changing all the time.
Yeah.
We always have to constantly adapt. The idea that it's going to be one way is not guaranteed. I mean, like, I think like a teaching gig is pretty solid. However, now they see that you can teach online.
Yeah.
Maybe they can hire people adjunct online. I mean, the thing about all of this is, like, we taught half of a semester online, completely online. No ensembles, no anything. And maybe this isn't the best for music, obviously. But in general, for teaching, it's like now the students are, I mean, middle school students are on Zoom. So it's like every student that is alive right now is accustomed, is comfortable taking an online class.
Yes.
So now if I'm like, you know, I'm on the road for 2 weeks, I'm going to teach all my classes online. The students aren't going to be caught off guard by that. They're going to do it for like a year.
Yeah.
So I just think, yeah, the model is always changing and we're always going to have to adapt. And I have no idea about the club scene and like, I mean, I still have a lot of dates scheduled with Shai for the winter, but I don't know if those are going to happen.
Do you have friends in New York who have left?
Shai's one of them. Yeah, he left. He moved out. He's in Israel.
He went to Israel.
At least for the time being. Yeah. Yeah, he broke his lease and moved all his stuff. And
the question to me now becomes more than ever, will the next generation of players move here? Will your students, when they graduate, will they move to New York?
That's a good question. And I don't know what the answer was. I don't know what the answer was before the pandemic.
Yeah.
I don't know if they would move to New York before the pandemic. I honestly don't.
Oh, you don't even know if they would before the pandemic?
Yeah. I mean, me moving out of New York in 2020 isn't like me moving out of New York in 2015.
Huh. You recognized a difference in the world around you.
I mean, just like me leaving, I'm on Instagram. I have my roots are deep in New York.
Well, that's the question. Your roots are deep in New York. They always will be. You've got that credibility and you've got that track record behind you. But what if you don't ever have that?
Well, I would say that there's going to be a very select group of people who I would say like need to be a part of New York to like help them grow into the musicians that they should be.
Yeah.
And I'm talking about like the most promising young musicians. Everybody, of course, everybody would benefit from being around, like being in New York and being around that scene. But musicians like Joel Ross. Yep. Emmanuel Wilkins. Then I Adam O'Farrell. I mean, he's sort of a different beast entirely, but yeah. Like. For them to like reach their potential in terms of their development, yeah, that they need to be around the people, like-minded people, and that's most definitely going to be in New York. Most often going to be in New York.
Yeah.
So I think for younger musicians at a really high caliber, yeah, it's pretty essential, and that's who I think will come to New York no matter what, anyway.
Yeah.
But there's so much music happening all over the place.
Totally.
I mean, I'm sort of like totally turned off by anything online at this point. In terms of listening to music, I just want to hear something live.
I'm super curious about that. I'm really curious to know if we do this for 6 more months or whatever.
I don't know.
If what that's going to mean. And, and that reminds me of the question that I wanted to ask you. While we're talking, is like, how comfortable would you feel going on tour? Like, if Shai called you and he's like, hey, guess what? Everybody, they say, the promoter says it's cool. There's going to be social distancing. It's going to be a lot of outdoor gigs, and they're going to like take everybody's temperature, and we're going to go to, Italy or whatever. Like, how do you feel about the idea of going out there? So much of playing live means traveling and putting yourself at risk. Like, what does that feel like to you when you think about that?
I'm not really that concerned because I'm not around anybody who's high risk.
Yeah.
So for me personally, I feel like I'm in good enough health that it's not going to have an adverse effect on myself. And if I was on tour, I would be socially distanced from everybody but the band. I wouldn't be too concerned.
Yeah.
If Shai and his management team went through the trouble of like making it happen and they did the best they could to make sure they care, they're good people, that they did the best they could to like make sure that everything was as safe as possible, then I would do it, of course. But I can't imagine that you're going to have an audience that's going to be down for that.
Yeah.
I was in the supermarket earlier today in the grocery store, and I had a mask on, and I walked by another guy with a mask, and he literally, this is not a New York supermarket. Yeah. It's a Texas supermarket. So you have like 8 feet in between, the aisle is like 8 feet wide. And I was walking by with my grocery cart, and this other gentleman in a mask like plastered himself against one of the sides, to just keep his distance. So it's like, I don't know. Are we going to have audiences? That's really the question. But I will say I did play a gig recently.
Did you?
Yeah, where I'm in Texas. They don't care about anything. So yeah, and so I played a gig with Bobby Sparks and some other guys from Dallas. And it was weird. It was my first gig in, 2 months?
Yeah. What did it feel
like? It was everybody's first gig. Everyone was like giddy to start. Like we hadn't played with other people in 2 months. And then the drummer, like a really great drummer, I won't name him, but like his hand started cramping up an hour and a half in the gig, like couldn't finish the gig.
Man, this is exactly what I've been saying. I've been saying that never in the history of humanity have we gone this long without playing together. We're going to all lose our chops. I mean, we're at home playing by ourselves, but it's not the same. It's a different muscle.
I think a lot of people, a lot of physical instrumentalists might struggle.
Yeah.
But I lived in L.A., so I know what it's like to lose my chops because I'm not, not playing a lot. So I have taken every precaution.
That's probably the funniest thing you said all day. I've lived in L.A. I know what it's like to lose my job.
No, living in L.A., you get really comfortable.
Yeah.
So I know how to avoid like having to restart from scratch.
Yeah, yeah. Man, I'm so happy to catch up with you. I feel like we have only scratched the surface, but I really want to just take your emotional temperature right now and just see how you're doing.
Not my pandemic temperature.
Yeah, exactly.
No, I'm great. I feel very fortunate to have gotten this gig in at the perfect time so that I can, this is a creative space for me. I feel like I'm in like a lockdown residency in a random city in Texas. That's how I feel.
Philip Dizack, it is such a pleasure to talk to you.
You too. And I look forward to continue reading your father's book. I read it like when I'm practicing my just technical stuff. In between every couple exercises, I read a page or two, give myself a break, and I've been thoroughly enjoying reading your dad's book again.
That is so cool. Text me anything that you want me to include in the introduction or any new music or anything.
I don't
like
care
that.
About anything.
Okay.
But what is funny is that I feel like we barely talked about anything.
Me too.
We barely got to anything.
But that's probably good.
We'll do one next 10 years from now. Every 15 years, 2005, 2020, 2035, we'll do the next one.
Thanks, man. Be well.
All right. You too. Bye.
There he was, my friends, Philip Dizack. Some conversations just flow like water, and that was one of them. What a treat to catch up with my friend. I'll be back again before you know it with another deep dive. Until then, I'll talk to you soon.